1 year went so fast. We met, I think, last year. So today is the first Bhagavad Gita class. With utmost humility, I am asking everybody, if there is any spiritual question which you would like more explanation, that will be a wonderful start. Any question, but it should be spiritual. Anybody? Break the ice. Okay. So today, you know, I will not introduce Bhagavad Gita. You know enough material now. What I would like to share with you, that it is up to the mental faculty, which is more important in our daily lives. Whatever we do, the thought behind that is important. So I'm giving you the example. Suppose in this room, in one of the corners, there are two things. One is the idol of Rama, and one is the idol of Guruji's, whose institution we have been running. Two idols. And one is Ravana. So three idols are lying on the table. And your choice is, so let us eliminate one more. Only Lord Rama idol and Ravana idol. Two idols on that table. And if I ask you, please go and pick up. It is your choice. So what do you think what people will do? Or what go and pick up one of those? So majority of the people, what they will do?
Rama.
Right? Am I right? I think 100% will pick up Rama, nobody will pick up Ravana. Now let us say this scenario, because we are talking of the mental faculty. If I say Lord Rama's idol is made of clay and Ravana's idol is platinum, gold, which is about $10 million. Now what is the answer? Rama will be lying there. Ravana will be hot selling item. So this is what we do. We have no concern with Rama or Ravana. We are looking for the material value. Material value. Am I right? And it is a funny illustration, you know. Very simple, but the answer which we gave just now, it was Ravana and Rama. In first instance, there was no value system. But when I put the value, right away we picked up Ravana. We didn't care that I am a devotee for the last 20, 30 years, worshipping this great Lord, asking so many boons. I immediately shifted my thinking. So the point is, whatever our deep down thinking is, that is what we do. That is what we do. On a peripheral surface, we may pretend to be something, but deep down we are something else. And spirituality demands to reconcile this. Because we are professional. We are professional in our own ways. We are doctors, engineers, attorneys, financial product experts. And so many other professions. And we do those things very professionally. But spirituality, we are defeating. With the simplest illustration, now you know what we did. And it's sad. It is sad. It was comical, but it is sad. So what we should do? Bhagavad Gita give you the direction. Bhagavad Gita give you the tools. Bhagavad Gita gives you the understanding. Bhagavad Gita gives you the spiritual insight. Bhagavad Gita gives you the twilight of the life journey. Bhagavad Gita can connect you to the divine forces. Bhagavad Gita can change you from inside out. That is what Bhagavad Gita is. So going back to the attitude problem, that we do things what we are deep down. We are just looking for the opportunity. If the opportunity comes, we compromise our values. If there is no opportunity, everybody is honest. We are all honest. But when the opportunity comes, then the answer is different. And spirituality directs, forces you to think on that aspect of life. That when you have all the opportunities, there should not be greed at that time. But it will not happen all of a sudden. It has to be practiced on a daily basis on small things. Small things. Like going to office. In time. If I am not in time in the office, I am practicing something else. Doing your job professionally. When we are in the office, most of the time we are thinking of the home. What my wife is doing, what kids are doing, they have to go to school, they have to do this thing. And when I am home, I am worried about the boss, my assignments, deadlines, what will happen, my promotion is coming, my that memo, I didn't reply to that email. So, who is doing that? I am doing that. You are doing that. On an individual level, not group, individual level. But there is a better way to eliminate the tension, pressure of day-to-day life. It's easy. It's doable. We all are competent. We can do it. But first of all, I must be aware how to do it, how to do it in the right way. And the right way is the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita. Because when this knowledge came into existence, there were no religion on this planet. I am talking this planet Earth. Maybe in the galaxy somewhere, there may be some other religion, but on this planet, there was no religion. All religions came afterward. So each and every thought of Bhagavad Gita is a universal thought. It is not sectarian. It is not addressed to Hindus. We foolishly say that Bhagavad Gita is a Hindu book. No. It is a universal knowledge. Don't put a stamp. Keep it open. Chemistry is not Hindu. Geometry is not Muslim. Astronomy is not Buddhist. They are knowledge. So if you treat Bhagavad Gita as a knowledge, then the stamping part is gone. The whole concept becomes universal. And since we are a part of that universe, it is better to understand Bhagavad Gita in that set of mind. But if we are sectarian, we think we are Hindus, it is our book, we are making a fundamental mistake. So keep the mind open. Let the fresh air come. And fresh air can only come through the wisdom of Srimad Bhagavad Gita. God is one. Everybody knows that. So the message should be one. There should not be a second message. And there must not be a second message. And the message is, we are all one. In Bhagavad Gita chapter 15, I have been stressing more than enough for the last, I think, 3-4 years, that sarvasya chaham haridisannivishto mattaha samritir jnanam pohanam cha vedej sarvai rahme vedyo vedan kridhe avidhev chaham. Lord Krishna says, I am seated in the heart of everybody. I am the memory. I am the forgetfulness. If intuitively you hold these thoughts, then you are connected to the divine forces. But if I bring to you the awareness that Lord Krishna, Christ, Rama is seated in your heart, do you believe that? That is the question. Do we believe that Lord Krishna is here? Lord Rama is here? Christ is here? Do we believe? I'm asking. We don't believe. We have read it, we have heard it many, many times, thousands of times during the course of our life, but we don't believe. We are looking in the churches, in the temples, in the gurudwaras, in mosques, but we do not believe that Lord is here. So if I practice, because I have to do my homework, nobody else can do your homework. Saints, gifted souls, and an ordinary person like me can bring the awareness to you. But you have to do it and hold it. So if, suppose, I start believing profoundly, total, complete conviction that Lord Krishna is here, what will happen? Can you imagine that? Your body will become a temple. Right that moment, your body will be transformed into a temple. So, what happens? Garbage in, garbage out. Nobody takes garbage in the temple. So, my eating habits will change. I will be very qualitative, what I pick and what I put in my mouth, because this is a temple now. My thinking will change. I will not be greedy. When you go to temple, what you do? For that half an hour, 20 minutes, you try to pretend to be very close to all that divine forces. But if I say that Lord is here, now my conduct will change. I will not hurt people. I will do what I say. I gave you the example of the day that we meet people in the morning and I say, sir, good morning, and he says, good morning. But inside I am thinking, my day is gone, because last time I met this guy, my whole day was spoiled. But I didn't tell you. While saying good morning to you, my thought behind that was that I should have not met this guy. Because last time I paid a heavy price. I missed the train. My boss gave me right and left. You know, my wife was so angry. Only because this was the first person to whom I met. But that was my thought. I was thinking that. But vocally, verbally, I was saying good words. So who has to patch up this incompatibility? I created, I have to do it. So that is what happens if I profoundly believe that Lord Krishna is seated in the heart. Not in my heart, in your heart also. So if Lord Krishna is seated here and in your heart also, then you are my reflection. You are my extension. So I will never have bad thoughts about you. But we don't do these things. We are looking, we go to temple half an hour, 1 hour, and we think it's okay. No, it is not okay. It's like You are pretending to be sleeping, but you are not sleeping. But if I am deep sleep, if you touch me, I will wake up. But if you are pretending to be sleeping and I touch you to wake up, you will continue to pretend that I am sleeping. You will never wake up. So life is like that. Bhagavad Gita says that since you are on this planet, it is a golden opportunity. If you look at the evolution, the theory of evolution, the epitome of personality of a man, that is the perfection of nature. Perfection. Each and every part of your body is the apex of engineering. Look at the whole formation of your body. And that's a complete evolution. And it is still evolving. So do you think it is by accident? No. This is the golden opportunity. Other creatures, other lives, they don't have five senses. I shared that thought also before. We have complete five senses. But we have the ability, capability and resources to develop the sixth sense, which is called spiritual eye. We can do it through meditation, through yoga, through self-discipline. So, such a beautiful package, and we are not using it to its optimum level. Who is missing the point? We. Some people get the message early on. Some people get it when they become old and the time is not there. Because every thought has to be practiced. Because we are a product of practice. Whatever I have been practicing, I am. You are. At your own level. So, qualitative habits have to be practiced. Otherwise, you cannot sustain this thought. Another thought coming out of the same platform, that our minds are not pure. We have put so much garbage here. New thoughts, good thoughts, positive thoughts cannot enter. You have to squeeze it and make a space. That we don't do. And meditation and yoga is the art to squeeze your mind. Let the negativity pour out. Make a space. So the new and fresh ideas enter and you have the ability to sustain it. Because whenever there is a good talk, it looks very good. But after half an hour, if he asks, what was the talk, 90% is gone. Some people may be lucky to hold 5-10%, but usually we let it go. And it's not our fault, because we don't have the space. When the sponge is full, doesn't matter, you put it in the ocean or in the river, it cannot hold more water, because it's already saturated. You have to take it out, squeeze it, and then put it. But that we don't do. That we don't do that. And we think, if my job is good, my household is peaceful, I think that's it, I got it. No. It's a changeable world. Everything is changing with the speed of light. What you are today, you may not be tomorrow. While you are listening, you are changing. I am talking, I am changing. The whole world is changing. So don't think anything is permanent. All our assets, all our names and fames, all my possessions, all cars and buildings, all certifications, they zeroed out at the end of the day. So if that is a message on the wall, why am I not getting it right? Why I don't regulate my thinking make it a pivot and revolve around that pivot. But our focus is on other things. We pretend to be spiritual, but we are not, because we don't focus. Like, if I say you are my best friend, what I am saying? If I say you are my best friend, because I am focusing my whole being on your positive side, on your merits. That is why you are my best friend. But if I change it, if I change my thinking towards you, now you are my worst enemy. Because what I am doing now, now I am putting my whole focus on your negative points. Intentionally I am ignoring your positive side. But who is doing? Me. You are the same person. So we make lot of friends during our lifetime. And we make so many enemies. But the people are same. If you are moving in a group of, let us say, 20 people, honestly review your, what I am saying, this style of making friends and making foes. You will find you have done many times that. Because it is my thinking. Through my thinking I make friends. Through my thinking I make enemies. When I'm making friends, I am focusing on the merits. When I'm making foes, I'm focusing on the negative side, demerits. So we started the discussion, the attitude and the thinking. I gave you the example that when we put a value to anything, our thinking changes right away. Because we have not been practicing. Theoretically, I may be saying million times, honesty is the best policy. It's okay. What about when the opportunity comes? Am I honest? I gave you the example of Lord Rama and Ravana. We were not honest. You're not honest. From the face of it, it looks we are all right. But deep down, the spirituality is challenging you to check yourself and tick mark what is happening inside. And spirituality is the journey of inside. It has nothing to do with outside. But once your inside is realigned, recalibrated, refocused, your outside is a gift. Your interaction with people, you will change the society. You will be moving around people who will boost up your that type of thinking. You will be qualitative selecting the people. Your production in the office will be very qualitative. And your raises, your advancement, nobody can check it because you are par excellence. Your way of talking and doing your assignments are totally different. And one more thought, because we are all professional, we are all young. I'm just infusing in you, challenging you to try to experiment this also. When you go to office, what do? We think I'm working for this boss. My boss could be anybody. But if I am profoundly believing Lord Krishna is seated here, so I am working for him. So if my boss is not there, he is always there all the time. I cannot fool around. I have to give him the best in me. So my quality will improve. Other people will be working for the boss. I will be working for the bosses of the boss. When the time of raises comes, advancement comes, step in increase comes, I will excel. I will excel. So this is what happens. This is the bonus, the dividend of inside investment, getting outside benefits. But we are doing the other way around. We are putting 99% all our resources, strengths on the outside. and lived very little inside. Half an hour going to church, half an hour going to temple, Gurudwara, we think it is enough. There are 24 hours. We think it's okay. It is not okay. It is not okay. And it's not a pessimistic thought. It is a revolutionized thought. It's a very positive thought. It will make you to stand up and challenge yourself. It will not make me lethargic. It will not make me weak. It will not make me stupid in the eyes of people. Because you are very strong inside. So, Bhagavad Gita, the wisdom, the direction is, invest in your inside also. In chapter 2 in Bhagavad Gita, the main message is that we are not the bodies. We are living in the bodies. Do you appreciate this distinction?
Yes.
Do we believe in? Honestly.
No.
We don't believe. But we know. So many Mahatmas, so many books, so many TV shows. Every year, lot of Mahatmas come from India with lot of good sermons. And this is one of the sermons. Every year it has been repetitively shared that we are not the bodies, we are living in the bodies. But I am asking you with utmost humility, do we believe? Do we believe?
We don't remember it.
That's the problem. And it is a simple thing. I'm not making up anything. I'm just challenging you that simple things we don't believe. Suppose, for discussion, we believe that we are not bodies, we are living in the bodies. Right? Right now. What will happen? What is the implication of this idea? That I am not the body, I am living in the body. What's the implication?
Lots of association will go away.
Say it again.
Lots of association will go away from your mind.
Body is temporary.
All our worries, all our tensions, all our oppressions and all our possessions, they relate to bodies, believe it. But if you practice this, remind yourself when the day, the moment you get up in the morning, repeat to yourself 10 times, I am not the body, I am just using this body. I have rented this skeleton, I will give it away. When it is tired and worn out and wear and tear is there, I will go, let it go. What will happen? You will be levitating in your thoughts. All the bondages, all those strings will be cut off. So if I am not the body, I am living in the body. It's like renting a car, leasing a car and owning a car. I gave you example, I think last year. Car is a car. I go to the dealer, if I make a full payment and take the car from the showroom, now I am the owner. But if I sit there, sign a couple of documents and lease the car, so I am not the owner. Owner is the dealer. In the first instance, I am the owner. Now you tell me which is a better option. Economically, financially, people may say owning the car is better. But spiritually, I am saying, leasing a car is better. All the problems of car relating to car are the problems of the dealer, not yours. There is a contractual obligation that 3 years, 4 years, whatever the duration of the lease is, he has to take care of that. If I don't misuse it, I should not be misusing it, I should not be abusing it. Normal wear, tear, everything else, it is dealer's problem. But if you say you are owning the car, now every morning you will get up and you will be going around the car. Kahi dent to nahi lag gaya, kisi ne laga to nahi diya, I was sleeping, you know. So I will be creating a kingdom of worry relating to that car. This is exactly what we are doing. We don't think that this body is on lease. You have to return it to Lord Krishna. You have signed the lease. It has to be given it back. But he will accept this body only if I have not misused it and abused it. Normal VTL is okay. Everybody will be old. It's a matter of time. Normal VTL is accepted. But misusing and abusing, like the dealer will not accept, Lord Krishna also will not accept. I will suffer. I will suffer. The same concept is applicable on us. So if I profoundly believe that this body is on lease, I have to return it to Lord Krishna, what I will do? I will take prudent care. I have to return it. So, I will not put the garbage in, which I used the word before. Because I have to keep this body intact, I have to return it. Whatever the lease is, 50 years, 60 years, 70 years, does not matter. Nobody has the time. We should not think that young people have more time. No. It may be a day. Today may be the last day. Time is over?
About like. We can take 5 minutes.
5 minutes. So we will try to wrap up. We will continue on that. I have challenged you from inside out today. I didn't touch Bhagavad Gita. I gave you a few examples just to challenge yourself, to change your thinking, make a space, bring the new ideas. But it can only happen only if I make a space. And how to make a space? Bhagavad Gita is a guide, is a tool, is a direction. But the only thing is I have to bring the conviction. Conviction. Because it's a research-oriented philosophy. Nobody has challenged. There are 700 verses from the time immemorial. Lot of brilliant people came and gone. Nobody said it should be 701 or 699. No. So it's a complete package. And since when it came into existence, this knowledge, there was no religion. So every thought is universal thought, applicable to the whole humanity. Because everything is addressed to the globe, to the humanity. But we are lucky. We have our own sanskars. We were born in India. And we have product that way. So we have the advantage. It's like a race. You are standing at a 10-yard, I am standing at the 5-yard. The person who is at the 10-yard distance, he will win the race anywhere. He's already 5 yards ahead of me. So we are ahead of the world. Lord Krishna was in India, in Mathura. So that is our advantage. And he gave the philosophy. He expounded these ideas. So, let's wrap it up. Next session, we will start Bhagavad Gita, chapter by chapter. But I will focus this time differently. What this chapter, what is in for me, and for my family, and for the society? Spirituality is not the abstract art. Spirituality is interaction. When you are spiritual, your walk and talk should inspire people. I will stop backbiting. I will stop telling lies. I will become qualitative. In the corporate world these days, quality is the most discussed topic. And spirituality can give you the guidance how to create quality, not only in the office, but in your own home. Because we are the king and queen of our own domain. And our domain is our family. Jai Shri Krishna. Thank you.